done by 10:50? Right? Is that the time on the schedule? Okay. Sorry. Well, good morning. My name is Rodley Ortiz. I'm on the pastoral team of Pioneer Memorial Church there on the campus of Andrews University. I'm really glad to be here, believe me, especially at this time of year. It's a little bit chillier up there. Some of you have passed through there. In a lot of ways, I say that Andrews is kind of like Jerusalem. Everybody kind of passes through there at some point, whether for some seminary degree or later for some seminar or conference, something like that. But I have the privilege of overseeing evangelism there at PMC and the campus of Andrews University. And today we're going to talk about maximizing social media. It's a pretty broad topic. Hopefully this is going to touch upon some pressure points that you have in your life. We don't have time to, ideally, we'd be able to go through and each person would say, you know, here's what I'd really love to learn about. I thought I was actually going to be in a much smaller room and this could be a smaller group and we'd be able to do that, but this is a little bit larger group and we don't really have the time to do that, unfortunately. So I'm praying that this is helpful to you guys. Why don't we begin with a word of prayer and then we'll jump right in. Father, we thank you for every single person that's here this morning. We thank you for the medium and the power of technology as well. So we just pray that through your Spirit, you would bless us and guide us, for we do ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Would it be more helpful if I stood up here, or does it not really make a difference? Maybe for cameras. Okay, maybe for the sake of the cameras, it would be a little easier for them, so I'll stand up here. I already introduced myself, but we're just going to jump right in. We don't have a lot of time, and we have a lot of important material to cover. Please get this into your spirit. That quote right there. Being involved in social media is a missiological imperative. A lot of people think that social media is cute. I don't have the time for that stuff. I'll leave it up to you younger people. I don't really have time to figure it out. Maybe some of you have said those things. Certainly you have heard those things or have thought those things, perhaps some of you. But let's be really clear this morning, and please receive the spirit in which I say it, hopefully a positive, encouraging spirit, that being involved in social media is absolutely, positively a missiological imperative. If you care about lost people, you need to be involved in social media, and I'm going to talk to you about why. Social media is the place where the largest mission field on earth actually lives. Now, in the last 200 years, we've had several different missionary movements, haven't we? Around 150 years ago, 200 years ago, we had this great missionary movement in which the Western world began to go to the world, right? So North America, England, we began setting up missionary societies all over the planet. That was a good thing. All of a sudden, in about 1960 or so, a missiologist by the name of Leslie Newbegin, he was one of the first ones to begin to write about it. He had been a pastor in England, not a Seventh-day Adventist pastor, but a pastor in England. He moved to India, where he was a missionary there for about 40 years, and then he came back in the 1960s. And as he began to interact with people in England, he began to notice that England had become a radically different place. Whereas before, it used to be kind of mono-ethnic, right, primarily English, white people. All of a sudden, he began to notice that all of a sudden, there's people that look differently than he does. All of a sudden, he began to notice that there's people that believe differently than he does. No longer were most of the people Christian. Now, all of a sudden, a lot of people were beginning to believe other things. And so that's when he penned those really memorable words, "Can the West be one?" So one of the first missiologists that began to wrestle with this idea of the Western world being a mission field. And so here we are in 2017, and there's no missiologist on earth that doubts that North America and the Western world, Western Europe, Australia, postmodern societies, that indeed they have become one of the primary mission fields on earth. You know why? because the world has come to us. They've come to our universities. They've come to our cities. Now, notice this. Most missionary movements in history have been bound by place and territory. But I would like to suggest to you that a third missionary movement is afoot, and it deals with social media. And that's why I say that social media, it's actually the place where the largest mission field on earth actually lives. They see themselves as being part of, it doesn't seem like a physical place, but indeed it is a destination. It is a place where a lot of people reside, where they feel comfortable. In a lot of ways, that's their home. It's their third space. It's their connecting place, whatever you want to call it. But it's certainly a mission field. Now, check out this statistic. This is the most recent statistic that Facebook has released, and that's as of September of 2016. Every single day, look at this number, almost 1.2 billion people every single day get on Facebook. Let me ask you a question, because I believe that most of you are on Facebook. Let's just see a quick show of hands. How many of you are on Facebook? Okay, some of you are not on there. Okay, that's all right. We're not going to shame anybody today. But almost 1.2 billion people every single day, they get on Facebook. A lot of people, maybe you're one of those, check Facebook many times, 10, 20, 30, 40 times in one day, because they're checking on statuses and updates and all that kind of stuff. So here's the question. Who should be on Facebook? First of all, your church should be on Facebook. Now, I wish we had the time to talk about websites. I could talk a lot about websites and kind of digital marketing and all that. We don't have time. But please believe me when I say that, and you've probably heard this before, but I'm going to say it again, that websites and social media usage is the front door of your church. When I visit a new town and I want to visit a Seventh-day Adventist church, I don't open up the Facebook. I don't randomly show up to a Seventh-day Adventist church. No, I go online, I go to Google, I go to Facebook, and I'll type in Seventh-day Adventist churches in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, for example. And I'll take about 2 minutes to do this. I'll quickly poke around at some of the websites, and the one that has the nicest looking website, that's where I'll go. It's true. Because I assume they have their stuff together. If I see, and I hope I'm not offending anyone here, one of those like Adventist Church Connect websites that have never been updated, have never really been used, or maybe you've put something on there a few years ago and it's just a static website. If I see one of those, I completely dismiss it. I don't go there. Okay? Because it looks like you haven't put any effort, any intentionality. And so I generally expect that I'm not going to hear an inspiring sermon, and I'm definitely not going to get an inspiring worship service. So I don't mess with it. And guess what? Someone that is considering visiting a Seventh-day Adventist church, maybe you invited them or a friend, a member of your church invited them to the church, they're going to do the same exact thing. And believe you me, if you don't have a decent-looking front door, which is your website and social media, they're probably not going to go. Unless you guys are like this, right? And they really trust you personally a lot. All right. So being on social media, of course, it's a kind of front door to your church, but it also gives your church an incredible amount of credibility. It helps you to connect with the community. How many of you have a Facebook page for your church? Okay, that's good. That's very, very good. We'll talk about some best practices for how to use social media with your church in a few minutes. Now, a lot of people think, well, as long as I have a Facebook page for my church, then I'm okay. Let me talk to the pastors and perhaps the elders, the leaders for just a moment. You also need to have a Facebook page. You also need to be involved in social media. Here's this kind of perhaps sensational sounding premise, but I believe it's true. If you're not on social media, you don't exist. It's true. Let me say that again for emphasis. If you are not on social media, you do not exist. Social media, when somebody says something to me about someone, they say, hey, do you know this person? I go on Facebook and I search the person's name. You do the same thing, don't you? It's kind of like the Rolodex. In rare occasions, I can't find someone. Especially for young people. If they cannot find you on social media, it doesn't matter whether or not you actually accept their friend request. But if they at least see that you have a presence there, you exist. If you don't have a presence there, you don't exist. You're not connected in this society in their eyes at all. So I'm sorry to break it to you like that, but it's true. You simply don't exist. Now, a lot of people are afraid to be on social media because they think that, well, if people saw some of the things that I tweeted, they wouldn't respect me as a pastor. And this kind of comes from an old school mentality in which a pastor needs to present himself as the pastor and kind of very serious and very dignified, and I have to be in a suit all the time and I have to wear a tie all the time, otherwise they won't respect me as a pastor. Well, guess what? In this generation, it's the opposite. Transparency corresponds to trust. When you share on social media, of course, I'm not interested in hearing about any, you know, random thing that you're eating about either, okay? But there are things that you can share about. And when you share on social media, it humanizes you, and all of a sudden people trust you. I have an ebook that I wrote called Why Every Leader Must Blog. If you go, I'm not here to pitch this, but it's I give it away for free, by the way. It's on my blog. I'll give my blog at the end, modernecclesia.com. If you go to any website, if you go to any blog post on my website and you sign up your email address at the bottom of a blog post, it'll get sent to you automatically. But in that little ebook, I share some different statistics about this principle and some different studies that have been done on CEOs and leaders and the kind of difference that it makes, and your ability to lead other people changes depending upon whether or not you use social media. Why? Because transparency corresponds to trust. If you don't share, and if you're not on social media, people will not trust you and they will not connect with you. Another principle, being on social media brings you to the table where conversation is taking place. If you're not on social media, you're not going to be at the table. People would love for you to be there, especially as a pastor. I'm telling you, your church members, and not just young people, right? Not just, you know, 20-somethings or 18-year-olds and college kids. No, no, no. People would love to interact with you on social media. But if you're not on there, it's not that you're not invited. They want you to be there. You're refusing to come to the table. All right. So here's the big question, because everybody says, well, I don't have time to be on everything, but let's quickly do a quick survey of some top social media platforms. Of course, the big three, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Facebook is the biggest one of all. But there's also Snapchat, and there's also, I mean, there's quite a few other ones, but there's, how many of you have heard of Musical.ly? Anybody heard of that? Okay. A young lady there in the back, which proves my point. Let me get off of this slide for just a minute. People say, what social media platform should I be on? And what I would tell you is it depends on the kind of people you want to connect with. Everybody and their mother mostly is on Facebook. If you want to reach a general audience, kind of, there's no arguing, you just need to be on Facebook. Just be on Facebook, okay? Just get on Facebook. You need to be there. But some of the other platforms skew a little younger, particularly Snapchat. You've heard of Snapchat? Okay. It's not just a thing where people send each other, you know, bad pictures and things like that. It's a platform that people actually use for normal messaging and interacting and connecting with each other. You know, a few years ago, I was feeling pretty proud of myself there at Pioneer Memorial Church because we had a Facebook page and we would use it and send messages out in there. And I was connecting with one of our college students by the name of Joanna, and I said, "Hey, Joanna, so did you see the announcement that we put on our PMC Facebook page?" She said, "Pastor Rodley, no, I actually didn't see it. But if you would have put it on Snapchat, I would have seen it." And all of a sudden, a light bulb turned on. And I said, "Maybe I need to get on Snapchat." But before I did that, of course, I began talking to some other university students, and I said, "Hey, are you on Snapchat?" "Yeah." "Are you on Snapchat?" "Of course." "Are you on Snapchat?" A huge number of millennials use Snapchat very, very regularly. And if they find you, I'm not even expecting your church to have a Snapchat account. That's kind of like elite level stuff right there, right? But if you're trying to connect with millennials, you as the pastor or the elder, the spiritual leader, you should probably think about getting on Snapchat. And if you get a follow on someone on Snapchat, it means a lot. You know why? It's hard to follow someone on Snapchat. If you've ever done it, you know what I'm talking about. It's not a super intuitive social media platform to use. I when it first came out, I got on it, I tried to figure it out. I couldn't figure it out, to be honest. And then when this university student said, "Rodley, you need to be on Snapchat," I said, "Hey, could you show me how to use it?" And honestly, that was the first time that I felt out of place as far as social media. I was like, wow, things have passed me. But she showed me and I figured it out, and you know, it's not that big of a deal anymore. So if you want to connect with millennials, okay, you need to be on Snapchat. Now, there's this other one that I referenced, and I saw, I think, two people here reference that they have an account with Musical.ly. That is a social media platform. It's an app, came out about 2 years ago, where it's kind of like you lip sync to music, right? But it's hugely popular, not necessarily amongst the millennial crowd, but now it's skewing even younger, which in some ways is kind of scary, to be honest. And I'm talking about 10-year-olds, 11-year-olds, 12-year-olds, 13-year-olds. A lot of people that age are on Musical.ly, all right? I'm just putting that information out there. I'm not saying you need to be on there, but you should expect that early teens are on there. They're using it. And some millennials, of course, are on it as well. All right. Now, this is just a really quick analysis of some social media statistics. How many of you have heard of Life Church based out of Tulsa, Oklahoma? Senior pastor Craig Rochelle, one of the most pioneering churches on the planet. It's a non-denominational church. It's the largest church in America. It's based off of a broadcast model where they have a central location of about 800 people, and then from there they broadcast to about 50 different campus churches, all right? The Bible app that you have on your phone, you probably see that it says YouVersion, or it was made by that church. So the most popular Bible app on the planet was developed by this church, all right? A lot of evangelistic tools that a lot of churches use, and I'm going to talk about one or two of them, was developed by that church. I call them the Google of churches. They create all of these free tools, and they see it as their mission to resource the world church, and so they give it away. I say that to say that they have the social media thing down pretty well. They're on Snapchat, for example. All right? If you want to get an idea of some best practices and an idea of how some of these things work, follow Life Church on Facebook. Follow them on Twitter. They're also on Instagram. Of course, they're on Snapchat. See the kind of stuff that they post. And by the way, that's one of the best ways to learn, is just simply by observing and doing. That's what I do. To be honest, I'm kind of surprised, Nicole, when sometimes I get invited to speak at things like this, because I don't consider myself to be some kind of social media expert or anything like that. I'm just a very curious person, and I want to be where people are because I want to reach them for Jesus, plain and simple. And so I say, okay, if there's some new way that I can influence young adults and influence people in order to reach them for Christ, I want to try to figure it out. Yes, some of them take effort to figure out, like I mentioned about Snapchat. It was not easy. But now I do it. Not all the time, and look, we all have 24 hours in a day. But every now and then you can post something on some social media platform. By the way, my senior pastor, Dwight Nelson, when I first got there at PMC, I said, you need to get on Twitter. At least on Twitter. You know, Facebook is more personal. You have personal pictures. Not everybody feels comfortable friending other people on Facebook. But Twitter is a little more public in a sense. And he kind of brushed it off. He's like, nah, you know, I don't have time for that and blah, 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 whatever. So I let him sit for about a year. And then I wrote a kind of an article, in a sense, about five reasons why he needed to be on Twitter. And it convinced him, and he got on Twitter. And now he has almost 8,000 followers on Twitter. People want to connect with you. People want to connect with you as a spiritual leader. They're curious. They're curious about you. But you need to give them an opportunity, all right? Okay, so let's just jump back here to this slide here. And it kind of gives you an idea of popularity or use. They have 223,000 followers on Facebook, talking about Life Church. Second is Instagram, actually. I was a little surprised by that. And thirdly is Twitter. Now, this might not be the same for every church, but then notice us at PMC. We have 4,700 some likes on Facebook, 2,600 followers on Twitter, and about 110 followers on Instagram. We're not really, I'm on Snapchat, but we don't have a PMC Snapchat account. Like I said, that's not totally necessary. That's kind of elite level stuff, and you know, maybe one day. I will say that I think we could have more followers on Instagram if we were actually intentional about marketing that we're on Instagram. We don't spend a lot of time marketing. We just post and people start following. All right. Now here is a super important principle concerning social media use. Don't miss this. A lot of you are messing social media up if you have a church social media account because you're just posting announcements, right? You're like, okay, now we're doing this thing. Okay, now we're doing this thing. Now we're doing this thing. Who cares? Who cares, honestly? It's an ad and people zone out of ads. If that's all you do, people will completely disregard it. They'll probably stop following you as well. Here's a hugely important principle in social media. Give, give, give. Maybe give some more and then ask. But this is just a simple ratio. It was developed by this guy by the name of Gary Vaynerchuk. He has this huge social media empire, and he has this great article. If you look up give, 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 ask, you'll see quite a few different articles online concerning this principle. Does that make sense, guys? Give, 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 and then ask. Okay, so what kind of stuff are you giving? Here's some kind of things. And I'm talking about, let's say, your church Facebook page, all right? Let's say your church Facebook page. You can share an encouraging scripture or quote. By the way, always use an image. Always use an image on Facebook. If you don't use an image, it's not going to be as popular. Facebook automatically, through their algorithms, they rank higher and they allow more people to see things that have an image attached to it. There's a great, you know, you can, most of the stuff that we post on our social media sites are with little apps on our phones, to be honest. Super simple. You don't need a graphic designer. I use an app on my iPhone called WordSwag. WordSwag. This is just a bonus. You're welcome. WordSwag. There's also a website that I use and have used. My administrative assistant does most of our social media stuff, by the way, at PMC. It used to be me. I handed it off to her. There's a little website called canva.com, kind of like canvas, canva.com. If you go there, there are professionally made templates for social media that they give away for free. All you do is type in the quote that you want, spirit of prophecy quote, your scripture quote, whatever. You can download it for free, canva.com. We also use Canva. We use that to make posters and things. I mean, it's a great tool. So you can share an encouraging scripture or a quote. You can share a great resource, an article from Christianity Today or whatever it might be that you feel might be helpful for your audience. Share the quote. Share something silly. Yes. You might share something like, did you know that today is National Ice Cream Day? Have you had your ice cream today yet? Right? Something silly and funny. People like that. Right? It humanizes your organization. It humanizes your church. And they say, oh, these are real people. I like real. Right? By the way, there's been this huge trend in society the last few years. I wrote about this about 2 years ago on my blog, really long blog post, about how there's been this trend in society towards minimalism and a trend towards authenticity. It's kind of one of the primary buzzwords. And so even mayonnaise, right? Before they used to advertise, or they used to hide that they use eggs and, you know, this kind of stuff. Now they're saying real mayonnaise, right? Now instead of on bubble gum, instead of saying we use artificial sweet, they say we use real sugar. Just because there's been this trend in society towards authenticity and minimalism and realness. People want to connect with real people, with real organizations. You can do a behind the scenes. Say, hey, here is my office, what the inside of my office looks like. Whatever, you can do behind the scenes. You can offer to pray for someone on social media. Say, hey guys, every Tuesday we're praying. Right? You can set a day in which every day you come back, just want to let you know that we're praying for you today. How can we pray for you today? People will respond, I promise. So what should you share? You can share your church service. You can stream your church service on Facebook. Did you know that? There's this great little camera. We won't spend a lot of time talking about this, called Mevo. Mevo.com. You guys have one. Fantastic. Okay, wonderful. Great little camera. You don't need to have some kind of expensive professional camera production. If you can afford that, that's fantastic. That's even better. But you can use a little Mevo camera. You can set it up in your congregation, and all of a sudden you're streaming to your congregation via Facebook. It's not expensive. You can reach people you've never reached before. We're going to talk a little more about that a little bit later. So we talked about this principle. Please, please, please do not merely share announcements. It will kill your credibility on social media. People will unfollow you, actually. They'll unfollow you. All right, a few quick case studies. All right, so some of this has been a little bit abstract. Now we're going to get into some particulars, some examples to put a little flesh and meat on the bones. So at PMC, we've been cultivating a social media presence for a few years now. When I got there, there was a Facebook page, but it was just kind of dead on the vine. It wasn't being used, nobody was posting anything. So I see social media as evangelism, actually. So as a social media pastor, no one else wanted to take it up, so I said, well, I'll take it up. And so I took over the social media pages and I began posting things on there. And, you know, at PMC we have a discipleship process, transforming this generation to connect, grow, serve, go. Connect, grow, serve, go. It's our discipleship process. And every month we do an initiative called Go Projects, where we go into the community and we serve the community in some kind of practical way. The whole disinterested benevolence, right? Like Spirit of Prophecy talks about. And we were doing one called Free Haircuts for Kids, where we go into the public elementary school, and the plan was we're going to have a dozen barbers there, we're going to do it in the gym. And by the way, when we approached the local elementary school and we said, hey, we would love to give free haircuts to all of your elementary kids before Picture Day. So we found out when Picture Day was coming, and a few days before that, or the weekend before that, we said we want to do this event. We had a huge, I mean, everybody said yes. We contacted a local farm, and we said, look, we'd love to do pumpkin painting. This was in early October. Would you mind donating some pumpkins? They donated 200 pumpkins for free, super happy. Now, my mistake, I was coordinating this. I thought that we could use student barbers from the campus for something like this, i.e. non-licensed barbers. Apparently, this whole sector is pretty serious. And you can get sued, right, if, even though we were doing them for free, but if anything bad happens, you're in really deep trouble. So I found this out literally about a week before we were supposed to put this event on. So I said, oh man, what do we do? We were about to call the whole thing off, to be honest. Because this is the main event. Getting your haircut, but we also had like a fun fair. We had like bowling in the gym. Really cool stuff happening, but the haircuts was kind of the main event. Forgive me for using this metaphor, but I did a Hail Mary. I said, let me try something on Facebook. So on our church Facebook page, I put an announcement, and it's kind of hard to read right there. I said, hello everyone, we're looking for licensed barbers, hairstylists for a community project. Pioneer Memorial Church is partnering with Andrews University and the Barron Springs Public Schools to put in an effort where we give free haircuts for kids in grades 1 through 5, right before Picture Day. We basically put the word out to the community, and so we did a Facebook ad. You can turn a Facebook post into an ad. There's a little button down there called Boost. I paid $20 to boost that ad, and I said, Lord, you know why we're doing this. This is for your kingdom, to build bridges into this community here. Please. I paid $20. And all of a sudden people, and of course, you know, you can do targeted advertising. That's the cool thing about Facebook. You do targeted advertising. So I put in the keywords stylist, barbers, haircut. So that's why Facebook wants information from you, believe me. If you haven't fully filled out your little about section on Facebook, they remind you. Why? This is how they make money. They want as much information from you as they can get. So thank you to those that put in information. All of us, so I put this ad out and I said, you know, let's do, I think, a 10-mile radius or 15-mile radius. And all of a sudden, barbers and stylists in the community began seeing this because we did targeted advertising. And all of a sudden, they began responding. This was shared 48 times. Long story short, we had more than enough barbers and stylists for this event. We had a dozen barbers. They're like, hey, this sounds cool. I want to be involved in that. Hey, this sounds cool. Yeah, I love to do stuff for the community. By the way, no, we didn't give out any glow tracks there. We didn't give out any steps to Christ there. We said, we just simply want to love the community. That's it. I could talk a lot about that particular evangelistic principle as well. I believe in glow tracks, but don't diminish your influence by doing this kind of bait and switch, all right? If you're serving someone, serve them. Come back later and separately do the glow track thing. Don't do it at the same event. We can talk more about that later if you have questions. How many of you heard about Hope Trending? Any of you hear about that? Okay, a few of you heard about that. Hope Trending was this national, yay even, international event that we did based out of Pioneer Memorial Church and Andrews University. It was an evangelistic series that Pastor Dwight preached. but we were using a little bit of a different approach. And by the way, we crowdsourced just about every element of this series. If you don't know what that means, it's basically where you put out surveys out there to see which is more popular. So we crowdsourced the title, lots of different elements about this series. The NAD gave us a budget of $75,000. Locally, we raised $50,000 from Pioneer. So we had a budget of $125,000. Now, that may sound like a lot of money, but when we're talking about doing a large-scale evangelistic event, it's really not that much money, right? There's large-scale evangelistic events that use $500 or even $1 million they'll spend to do an evangelistic campaign. And we were striving to do a big campaign. Small resources, not a lot of people, using the staff at Pioneer, but doing a large campaign. Let me give you some of the basics of what we did at Hope Training, just so you can kind of catch a vision for it. It's a one-hour program, a one-hour evangelistic program. We began meeting with young adults on the campus of Andrews and people from the community, actually, and we asked them this question. We said, how can we do evangelism in order to help you reach your friends and your neighbors? And then we listened. That's all we did. How can we do evangelism in order to help you reach your friends and your neighbors? We did three rounds of these, right? We did three different focus groups. All of them shared the exact same thing. These three different focus groups were led by three different pastors on purpose because we didn't want to have any undue influence on the different groups. None of them knew what the other had gone through, and yet each of them shared almost the same exact thing. You know what they told us, particularly the Seventh-day Adventist ones? They said, whatever you do, please don't give us a one-hour-long presentation with 140 slides. You know what I'm talking about? I've preached a lot of those. But I'm just telling you, that's what they told us. They told us a lot of things, actually. And so that's how then we began putting the building blocks for this evangelistic initiative together. We said, well, maybe we're onto something. So it's a one-hour program, start to finish. There's a 20-minute message, just 20 minutes. Now, you can imagine if you're going to do a 20-minute presentation on the Sabbath, you're probably going to have to use a little bit of a different approach, aren't you? You're not going to be able to prove everything in, you know, 20 minutes, how we typically try to do. And so we told Pastor Dwight, we said, look, you got 20 minutes. And he did it. But not just that, we had a program in which then there was going to be a 20-minute panel. And so immediately after the presentation, there was a panel of some young adults from our community and one of our chaplains, and they got up there, and they reflected and they talked about, on the platform, what Pastor Dwight had just talked about. And these people were receiving questions live from social media. So from Facebook, we had moderators on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram. We had a chat room, by the way. This was a form of online evangelism. By the way, you can go there right now. Well, don't do it right now, but later on, go to hopetraining.org. All the presentations are there in English and in Spanish. Hope TV got on board. They broadcast it. Esperanza TV in Spanish, they broadcast it. So it was kind of a big deal. So 20-minute talk, 20-minute panel discussion, and then there was some other interactive elements. There was these videos and a little musical element each night. 1 hour program though. We did it across 11 time zones. 11 time zones. This was streamed on Facebook Live, streamed on Hope Training, played on Hope TV and Esperanza TV. And by the way, you can stream live on Facebook using nicer cameras, not just the Mevo camera. If you happen to have an HD camera in your church, there's software that allows you to present your professional, or maybe not professional, production on Facebook Live. We've been doing that for our church services at PMC for a little while now. We did that for Hope Training. As I mentioned, we had chat rooms where, yes, question. I will need to get back to you on that. Our media team ran that piece. I don't know what the name of the software is actually, but I can get it to you if you send me an email. It was extremely, extremely interactive. If you go, by the way, to Life Church, we used a program, a platform that was developed by Life Church, this church that I was telling you about earlier. It's called the Church Online Platform. They give away an interface so that you can have chat rooms and so that people can actually make decisions online concerning your worship service. And so what we did is we had the live experience was at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard. You with me? The main event, if you will, was at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard. But then we had what we call, and this sounds like an oxymoron, live rebroadcasts happening every few hours to hit every major time zone. In other words, what that means is the next rebroadcast was going to happen at 11 p.m., 8 p.m. Pacific time. Are you with me? But we were going to have live people in the chat rooms. We had a rebroadcast happening every 2 hours after that, literally to span the entire globe, and we had people live and online 24 hours. Of course, not all from Bering Springs, Michigan. We asked contacted people in England, we had people in Australia, some different people in some of those time zones. They said, yeah, I'll be an online moderator. That's what we called them, online moderators. And through a relatively small team, we had a pretty huge impact. Now, I hope you can appreciate some of these statistics. 835,000 people on Facebook saw, you know, on Facebook you can see one of the videos scrolling. Doesn't mean you click on it, but you see something going by in your feed. Because we streamed things on Facebook Live, it was extremely shareable, right? That's where we got most of our eyeballs, actually, was through Facebook Live. Because people would see it, and then they would share it. And we told all of our people, you know, we called them our online ambassadors, all of our church members. We had people hosting watch parties, by the way. That was one of the big things about the series. We told our church members, we want you to host watch parties. So don't come to the main event. A few of you can come, but most of you out there, we want you to host watch parties. Go to your living room, invite your friends, your neighbors, and watch it live online. And a lot of people did that. A lot of people did that. So 835,000 people saw something related to Hope Training scrolling across their screen. That's a tremendous number, guys. That's a tremendous number. Now, check this next number out. 233,000 people actually saw some portion on Facebook Live of Hope Training. Over 250,000 people saw at least some portion of Hope Training just on Facebook Live. I'm not sure if you can appreciate that or not. Some of you are looking at me kind of. Here's what I'm trying to say, and please listen to me. We spend a lot of money doing lots of different evangelistic initiatives that don't reach a lot of people. We spend a lot of money. They reach 2,000 people, right? We do a big auditorium and invite people. This reached 233,000 people. We reached 149 countries. We had 1.2 million impressions on Twitter. That means that something related to Hope Training was served up, if you will, to 1.2 million Twitter feeds. This is by people retweeting and sharing, right? So there was this tremendous, tremendous reach online. I'm going to share a few quick lessons, and then I'm going to sit down, because I think this ends at 10:50. Yes?
Did you have any kind of understanding of what kind of results you reap from all that?
That's a good question. And that's really the main question that everybody wants to know is, well, how did things go? They went quite well. The main purpose of Hope Training was actually not to try to get a bunch of, it was not a reaping series. Okay. This was a seed sowing series, and we have an implementation guide. We talked about that. If you go to hopetraining.org/resources, you can get all of our resources there for free. And you can do this in your own church, by the way. You can do it in your own church. We said the goal of Hope Training is, during the Hope Training, hopefully you have relationships with some friends, your neighbors. This is simply an introduction. This is an introduction. After Hope Training is done, you now continue with that watch party, and now you, once a week, go through lesson number one, if you will. You go through the regular doctrinal Bible studies. Are you with me? Half of our watch parties, we had 255 registered watch parties across the nation. More than half of them are currently still studying with someone right now. Someone that attended their watch party. There was an average of 9 people in each watch party. There was an average of 2 non-Adventists in each watch party. We praise God for the results. We really praise God for the results. Here's some of the lessons. Social media and having a social media manager. We had a social media manager. I believe this made the biggest difference out of anything. We spent $2,000 on online advertising. But through the power of social media, we reached a huge number of people. Every new evangelistic initiative that happens needs to use social media in a smart way. If you don't, you're shooting yourself in the foot. Another major lesson, people are yearning for community and connection. People are yearning for it. You should have seen those chat rooms. I mean, we would have 300 people in one chat room. And they're going nuts in a good way. They were so pumped to be there. Some you could tell were Adventists. Some you could tell were non-Adventists. Some you can tell were Muslims. I remember one evening we were doing the presentation on the second coming, and people often say, hey, I'm watching from Saudi Arabia. I'm watching from the Philippines. This one person said, his name was Desert Wheels, Desert Wheels. He said, you know, I can't share my exact location, but I'm in Kazakhstan. And through what he was sharing, we could tell that he was Muslim. And he said, is what Dwight Nelson talking about the second coming, is that actually going to take place? I thought, wow. There's no way that we would have been able to reach into Kazakhstan without social media. And I'll just use this kind of as a final major point. When you do online evangelism, you are doing collaborative evangelism. People are yearning for ways to be involved in evangelism. Believe me, not everybody can do this thing, right? A knock on doors. That's kind of scary for a lot of people. Most people don't want you at their doors, period. But we said, guys, we need online moderators. We need people in these chat rooms. We need online ambassadors. And we had more people than we could use, actually. They were so excited to be there. And they were involved. And even Adventists who were not official online moderators, when non-Adventists would ask questions, everybody was jumping and, oh, you need to check out this scripture, or they were encouraging each other. They were so involved because we were giving them a practical way to be involved that they knew about and that they felt comfortable with. Finally, there's power in a panel. There's a lot of power in a panel. The panel that we had was just as important as a 20-minute presentation by Pastor Dwight. I have no doubt about that. Oftentimes, in evangelism, most of the times, we use the big man or big woman in the room kind of philosophy, don't we? We bring in that big name, but what if somebody doesn't connect with that personality and that person, and maybe if they don't fully understand something? Through using this panel, and because we were receiving questions live on social media, and we said, you know, guys, send in your questions now. And then we would submit the questions to the panel, and they were answering them live on the air. This made a huge, huge difference. So I talked about the Kazakh thing. I think that's the end. Let me just throw up this slide so you can know how to contact me. On my blog, modernecclesia.com, you can subscribe, and any new blog post that I write will automatically go to you. Just go to the blog post, click on any, go to the website, click on any blog post, and at the bottom of the blog post, you'll see a little spot where you can enter in your email address. I'll be honest, I haven't written in a little bit. I'm trying to finish this Doctor of Ministry degree, but more stuff is coming, I promise. Secondly, I'm on Twitter. Feel free to check me out on there. I don't accept everybody's Facebook friend requests just because, unless I've met you and know you, just because, you know, Facebook is more personal, I won't accept. So if I see a face I've never seen before, I won't accept them, right? So that's just kind of some security. But on Twitter, anybody can follow me there. And you can even email me, rodlie@andrews.edu, R-O-D-L-I-E. But this is actually an easier way to connect. So guys, is it okay if I pray with you as we close? Yeah? Let's pray together. Father in heaven, I thank you for all of my friends and my colleagues that are here this morning. There's a lot of the world that has yet to be reached. There's a lot of people online that have never been to church, but through our use of social media, they will be connected to the gospel message. And so I ask, Father, that you would convict us and equip us and motivate us to be digital missionaries online. Maybe for some of us in this room, it's a little difficult, and maybe it proves to be a little bit of an annoyance, but Father, please help us to reach these people that live online. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.